There are two ways to think about the colorization of old films. The first, an assumed general opinion of most colorists, is that it brings new life to the movie. It makes it more accessible to newer, younger audiences. The second way to look at colorizing films, and this one is held by most film purists and directors, is that it degrades the work of the filmmakers. The sets, lighting, costumes, and atmosphere are all set up to be shot and shown on black and white film. It ruins the mood and tone the filmmaker wanted because the colour scheme, more or less, is chosen by the colourist.
Say, who's got trouble?
We got trouble.
How much trouble?
Too much trouble.
Well now, don't you frown. Just knuckle down and knock on wood.
With a subject like this, you either deeply believe that it's the bastardization of monochromatic cinema, or you really don't care. But for the sake of this video, allow me to sidestep the continuousness of colorization, because this video is about the far less complex subject of deep neural networking, computer learning, and its place in colorization for film in the future. This is a website that uses deep learning to automatically colorize black and white photographs. It uses a dataset of millions of images to recognize what colors may go in what places, and sometimes it kind of works. Other times, it leaves a lot to be desired. Naturally, since it can colorize images, it should be able to colorize films. This feature is not built into the demo, but since films are just essentially 24-ish images per second, there is no reason why you couldn't simply break down the frames, colorize them one by one, and reassemble them. Needless to say, this is a long and laboring process, but here are some results. This is a scene from 1933's King Kong. Here's that same scene from the 1989 Turner Entertainment manually colorized version. And here is the automatically colorized version from the neural network. Nope, the real one is far more disappointing. Not exactly great. You can see that it's trying to create colours, but it just comes out looking a bit sepia tone rather than colourful. Let me remind you that this is being done frame by frame, which can result in a lot of incongruity between frames. Bad start, but just because that took 2 hours to put together should not be a good reason to stop. For this next test, let's take something that's already in colour, convert it into black and white, and run it through the neural network. I've noticed that it works quite well with elements like grass and sky, so I've chosen this scene of Hobbiton from The Fellowship of the Ring. And here is the automatically colorized version from the neural network. This is better, still quite ugly. It thinks these hills at the back are dirt or sand maybe. The sky seems to be the most consistent. It is reminiscent of an old worn-out VHS. But as soon as you switch back to the original, you see just how poor it is in comparison. The colours are totally wrong. The neural network is interpreting the image and trying to make it true to life, whereas the original image has such a strong, unrealistic fantasy green. This is a huge negative for the neural network. It cannot interpret and reproduce tone or mood. Let's see how it would handle animation. Here is Mickey Mouse in The Chain Gang from 1930. Here's the studio's attempt at a colorized version. And here's the neural network's attempt to colorize it. Yeah, this one's not very good. Very washed out. The colors are all wrong. It seems to think that rocks are red. None of the characters are defined clearly. Here are another few examples found on the web of people doing a similar sort of thing. So will this ever be a viable solution? Well, if it's improved greatly, which it probably will, then I would say yes. Film colorization was and still is an expensive and painstaking process. If the studio had a program that they could run their movies through and have it come out colorized, they would do it in a heartbeat. Because unfortunately, general audiences do tend to turn away from black and white film.
Surveys have shown that 50% of your audience will tune out immediately upon seeing a black and white image. You lose 90% of your audience with a subtitled film. And so the colorizing old movies seem like a way to bring these films into the future and wring some additional dollars out of them. Of course, it destroys the values of the films, the black and white cinematography.
The last test is essentially committing the ultimate sin.
Shortly before Welles died, the colorization of films began in the States. And one of Welles' last wishes, it said, was, please do not let Mr. Ted Turner put his coloring crayons to my greatest creation. Well, Mr. Turner decided that he would like to do that. Mr. Turner actually got the process underway. He had second thoughts. He had his attorneys look back at Welles' original contract, and there was a phrase in there, Welles shall deliver a black and white motion picture of a certain duration. They had second thoughts, so only the final reel of Kane was colorized and went to the vaults and was never seen.
Yes, that's right. Colorizing Citizen Kane. Sorry,